came kind of roaring down the stairs, and I looked up, and it was Amy. And she was very forthcoming with love, and very loving, and very caring, and loyal almost immediately. That surprised me for sure. I think there's a universal experience that we have. It cuts you. It really shakes your whole world.
Well, this month we have a special episode that takes a fresh look at the extraordinary Amy Winehouse. With her deep expressive vocals and heartfelt lyrics, the English singer rocketed to fame in the early 2000s, winning 5 Grammy Awards for her 2006 album, Back to Black. But acclaim came with real hardships. Winehouse became one of the most hounded figures in recent tabloid culture. In the press, there was constant scrutiny of her romantic life, her battles with bulimia, as well as her struggle with alcohol and drug addiction, a struggle that would ultimately cost her life. Now 7 years after the singer's death, one of her closest friends, the American photographer Blake Wood, has published a collection of his personal photos of Amy to pay tribute to the real woman behind the sensational celebrity headlines. From images of Amy playing drums at her home in Camden to sun-drenched shots of her relaxing on the beaches of St. Lucia, Wood, in his words, hopes to change the conversation that surrounds how Amy is remembered. Blake Wood joined me by Skype from New York to talk about Amy, their friendship, her fame, and the different side to Amy Winehouse that he hopes to share through these newly published photographs. Blake, welcome to the Tashin podcast.
Thank you so much for having me.
Before you first met Amy in 2007, had you already been a fan of her music? Was her music something that meant a lot to you?
Yeah. That year, I think prior to us meeting, her record Back to Black had come out in America, and I think everybody was pretty blown away by it. But myself, I was connected to her music definitely before we met.
Was there anything in particular about her music that you connected to?
I think her ability to articulate emotions, you know, through her lyrics, but also just pertaining to love and her ability to describe and, yeah, articulate love and how difficult love can be, romantic love. And yeah, I think at that time in my life, I was going through my first kind of heartbreak, and to have that music to kind of see me through that time in my life was, yeah, really special. And I felt almost indebted to her because of it.
Because it was a cathartic experience?
Yeah. I think it's almost like her voice can carry you through difficult times. She, there was a empathy and just a knowingness to her lyricism and the sound of her voice, for sure.
You're American, and Amy was from London. How did you end up meeting?
After that breakup that I was going through, I decided that I wanted to move to London. And Kelly actually was moving back to London as well, Kelly Osborne. And she had been a friend of mine for a number of years. And so we kind of moved back to London at the same time. And, you know, we're in our early 20s, and it was, you know, a new city for me. And I was just exploring and seeing, you know, everything that was going on there in the, you know, music and art scenes, which were booming then for sure. And Kelly had been friends with Amy for a number of years, and I knew that our paths would cross. I just kind of left it up to the universe for that to happen. And by chance, I came over to Kelly's house one night, and Amy happened to be there, unbeknownst to me. And she came kind of roaring down the stairs, and I looked up, and it was Amy, and she was blonde, which was kind of a double shock. And she walked right up to me and was like, "Hi, I'm Amy." And I immediately was like, "Hi, I'm Blake." And her reaction to that was kind of looked at me like I was messing with her. But and then Kelly chimed in, no, his name is Blake too.
Like, because her boyfriend at the time was named Blake.
Yes, exactly. So Kelly had left that night. So it was just us in the house, and we got to know each other and really shared a lot of, you know, stuff that was going on in our lives and got personal very quick. And there was just an instant connection between us.
Is there anything in particular that you can point to of why you seem to connect so quickly?
I don't know. I think, you know, we both were outsiders in a sense, and we just connected on being different and creativity and that drive to make, you know, use our lives to make things and to produce just work that is some representation of ourselves and how we see the world, and also kind of our relationship to how we romanticize things in life. And she definitely was someone who did that for sure. Even to down to like the music that we would listen to at that time, which was all like 60s girl groups and doo-wop. And yeah, it was very just almost overly dramatic with how we romanticized love and people we found attractive or artists or anything. It was just like gushing over it. And we had that similar way of seeing the world.
Was there anything that struck you about her in that initial meeting or those first few days that surprised you compared to how you thought she would be or imagined she would be?
Probably her ability to just be really loving and kind of open with that. I think most people have a wall kind of up around their heart and you know, get to know people first. But she was very forthcoming with love and very loving and very caring and loyal almost immediately. And that surprised me for sure.
Now, you mentioned in the book how you formed this really deep connection with Amy, you know, quite quickly. And, you know, you had your own personal apartment, but you also ended up spending a lot of time at Amy's apartment in Camden, practically living with her for periods of time. What was Amy the housemate like?
We stayed indoors a lot. It was difficult because of the press attention and the media attention at that time. And it wasn't really that safe because they were crazy. So we stayed inside a lot. We listened to music, we watched TV, watched movies, and we kind of lived in our own world a lot during those years. I would try to get her out of the house sometimes. We would go out at night. It was a little bit easier then. And we'd go to some gigs or jazz club or, you know, shopping once in a while during the day. You know, just try to sneak out and I'd try to create some normalcy. But yeah, she was fun to live with. She was so funny.
How so?
She was always 10 steps ahead of you and could come up with a zinger really fast. So her wit was incredible. She was very bright.
How did she relate to her fame? As you say, there's paparazzi out of the house. You're almost the two of you can't just leave anytime you want, at least not without being kind of harassed. What was her relationship to being in that situation?
Her relationship, I could only kind of guess. I mean, I can see how it was. It was not comfortable for her. I know that she wanted nothing more than to just be able to take the subway, you know, take the tube and just be unbothered by it and have that kind of normalcy, that anonymity that you can't really get with fame. But I think for me, it was surreal. You know, I'm 22 and I'm from Vermont and, you know, I've lived in cities before, but this was like, she was probably the most photographed person in the world at that time. It was surreal. It was, I can't describe it other than surreal.
And I mean, you also became the subject of some tabloid speculation.
I think anybody who was by proxy close to Amy or anybody who was around her at that time, if they could spin a story, they would. And I think I became an easy target. My name was Blake as well. And it just kind of the narrative that they created wrote itself. And, you know, they were able to create all these stories that were not true. And I was, you know, I was savvy enough to realize that, you know, I wasn't a famous person. They couldn't really just write about me in that way. So I was able to sue the main newspaper in the UK and they stopped writing about me. So that was good.
Well, what were they saying? That you were having
That we were having an affair and that, you know, I was supplying her drugs or just anything that would sell a paper, they would say, you know, and they'd speculate about who I was. It wasn't nice. It wasn't legal and it wasn't okay. And it was affecting my ability to work and find work. And, you know, I'd get into a cab or I'd get into a subway and people would talk about it, talk about me, ask me and negatively usually. And it wasn't okay.
Was it strange for you as, you know, you were still very early on in your career and kind of like an aspiring photographer at this point. And here you were becoming very close friends with someone who, you know, as you say, was one of the most famous people in the world. Was that strange for you to have such a close relationship with someone who was at such a level in their creative recognition?
Yeah, I think, you know, it was on my mind at times. I think it only really came up when I was very motivated to do things and to try to explore the world and make work. And she was at a point where she had kind of self-actualized, where she could really pick and choose if she wanted to do something or not creatively, or, you know, take some time off and figure things out. And I wasn't at that point. So when she would kind of want me to just chill or want me to just, you know, maybe stay in London full time, that was when I would have to kind of bring to her attention that I hadn't really done all the things I wanted to do creatively or reached a point where I wanted to in my career, and that she had. But other than that, I think she was who she was, no matter how famous, no matter how successful she was. She didn't change.
Can you tell me about how you first started taking photos of her?
I think, yeah, at that time, you know, moving to London, I was really just documenting everything that I was experiencing. And with Amy, my camera was in my hand, so it was just natural. It wasn't like, can I take your photo? It was just, I had my camera. She knew I was a photographer, knew I was an artist. And I think within the first week or two of knowing her, we were out, and she was still blonde, which was very brief. And we went out, we snuck out one night to this tavern in East London. And yeah, I just started taking her photo that night. And that's kind of where our work began.
This is the night where I think you had to sneak out in a van, right?
Yeah,
to go to the store.
We snuck out in the back of a work van, and it was quite an adventure.
And what was it like? Was it a relief to kind of for her to be able to actually go out to a pub?
Yeah. Oh yeah, I think any time that she could evade the press and just have a normal night out or just, you know, have some adventure, it was fun. I think she really, you know, enjoyed it. And we explored that place top to bottom, and it was a good night. It was a very good night.
Do you have any favorite photos from that night?
There's a few from that night. There was one of her when she was putting on her lip liner, and her silhouette was really beautiful. In the mirror, you can see it. And then one of her posing kind of after applying her makeup by the sink, and then just a quick candid shot that I took of her, which I later realized there was a star kind of graffitied above her, which was a nice moment that I didn't realize that I'd caught.
Now you mentioned, you know, the face of Amy that most of us in the public didn't get to see with all the tabloid press, but of course she also had her drug addictions and as well as eating disorder. I'm wondering how you personally dealt with that and being her friend and seeing this other side of her with these issues she was wrestling with.
Well, I think, you know, ultimately what you can do when you're close to somebody who is going through those things is just be there when they need support. And, you know, myself, I don't use substances. I don't drink. I don't do drugs. I never have. And I think, you know, those things didn't really play into our relationship or our friendship. It was kind of, yeah, the uninvited guest that she would go and kind of deal with and come back with. But, you know, I wasn't avoiding it or I wasn't not addressing it. I think I did everything I could and supported her through working towards sobriety as much as I can. I think ultimately sobriety is up to the person. And, you know, and when it comes to mental health and any of these issues, eating disorders, sobriety, all of that stuff, the person, it's really up to the person to work on those things. And I was there supporting her through it all, anything that she needed.
Do you think her problems were exacerbated by all the fame and attention?
Well, I think it's not fame or attention per se. It's maybe the way that the media hounded her. I think anybody would be affected by that. Addictions or not, I think anyone who would be hounded or stalked or just inundated by people trying to get a bad image of you would overwhelm anyone. And I think even now, if she could speak about it, she would just want us to move on from it because that wasn't who she was at her core. I think you could see in the images, there's a childlike quality to her that many people didn't realize. And that piece of her is something that she held very high. and wanted to, I think, hold on to, which is probably why she had a close relationship to children, because it is important. I think as we get older, we lose that inner child or that childlike quality to play, that joy. And I think that she was someone who tried to hold on to that a lot.
Do you think that was partly why she was so successful as an artist as well, was that she was in touch with that side of her?
Yeah, I think that the more we are able to create and play and have that playfulness through our work and through what we're doing in our lives, through our purposes, whatever that may be, it can really, yeah, there's a pureness to it and there's an ease to it that we forget and we get so serious about our work.
Can you tell me about what the kind of friend circle was like? Were the two of you usually alone together, or did she have like a bigger like community with her that you were kind of drawn into?
There was a community of friends for sure. It wasn't like 100 people, but yeah, there was a close group of friends that would, you know, come in and out, and new friends and acquaintances would come up. But yeah, we had 5 to 10 people that were around us at that time that were really close. But it was a tight knit crew. You know, there wasn't a lot of people around just because of the circumstances. And I think anyone who was close to her was pretty like protective of her because of the situation with media and people selling stories and people trying to just kind of exploit her because they could if they got close. And she wasn't, you know, she was very smart of who was okay and who wasn't okay. And, you know, she's pretty quick to shut it down if it was not a good person or someone of a good nature around her.
A lot of the photographs in this book are taking on a trip that you went with Amy on to St. Lucia together in 2008. Can you tell me about that trip? How did it come about?
It happened at the end of 2008. So we headed there. She went there right before Christmas. I got there the day after Christmas. And it was just, it was time. It was like, all right, we need to go and just get away from the chaos that is in London. And she loved St. Lucia. She had been there a number of times before. And so we all went there. And it was like a new beginning, a whole new thing. It was like a new chapter of our friendship and our relationship for sure. I got to know her on a much deeper level than I did even in London, and to be away from pretty much everybody and everything, and especially all the negativity, it was really refreshing and very special.
Did you see a different side of her?
Yeah, I did. It was one of the first times that I had seen her sober for an extended period of time. And I think once you get past all of that and you're away from the energy of a city and you're just on kind of a remote island, you really get to know people. So it was refreshing, and we just got to know each other in a much more a pure and kind of natural way, because we're just, you know, you're on a beach, you're in the sun, and there's not the stress of kind of city life and or the media attention that there was in London.
Like the paparazzi didn't follow her there so much?
They weren't allowed on the island. So any of the images that were taken in St. Lucia were from a boat. So it was a different, it was like we had space to do what we wanted to do. We had physical space without being stalked, basically.
Just looking at the photos, she definitely seems a really relaxed, you know, it's not an image that you would have seen in the paparazzi pictures.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, these are images made between two friends, you know, it's a collaboration between us. And I think what you're seeing is she's looking at me and I'm looking at her, and I'm trying to capture our connection and what we had as friends.
Is it true that she also kind of encouraged your career in photography?
Oh, yeah. I think she saw something in my work before I did. I mean, she was one of the first people to have a photo of mine up, you know, in their house ever, really. And she was proud of my work. And she was kind of, whenever we were out and we'd meet people, she would kind of describe me you know, as this great photographer or this creative, kind of like a creative director of hers, or somebody who, you know, had a similar eye, which was really nice. And I, you know, I was very shy then, so don't think I necessarily took it on board, but it was very, very sweet of her.
Are there any other favorite images of yours from the book that you'd like to talk about?
Yeah. Personally, for me, the image of her, the Polaroid that I took of her by chance on the beach, where she's sitting in a beach chair and she's bathing in the sun. It was the first time that I really saw her just be and kind of just at peace in herself, in her body, and, you know, just pure natural beauty. There's the beauty that's radiating from her, but also just that peace that exhale that I just wanted so badly for her to experience since I had met her. It was, you know, pretty much nonstop since, you know, that 2008. So this was like the first time I just saw her relax.
So after a while, you moved back from London to America.
Mm-hmm.
Did you stay in touch after that?
Yeah. You know, we were very, very close at the time. So I think me leaving was not something she wanted me to do, but I was just eager to make work, and I felt like I needed to go back to New York and explore some opportunities there. And just I was unsettled. I was at that time, I was really transient. I was bouncing between New York, London, and LA. I was really trying to find myself creatively and in my career and different things. And I think she understood that, but she also just wanted me to be in London. So it was difficult for us, but we did keep in touch. And thankfully, because of technology like Skype, we were able to just be on video chat, you know, every couple days. And that was also a way for her to connect to the world, because she was indoors so often that we would video chat very often, just, you know, connect and see each other. Even if I was in London, we would video chat.
Just from different apartments.
Yeah, yeah.
And did she seem like in good spirits mostly?
Yeah, I think 2000, you know, I left at the end of 2009. 2010 was a great year. I think she really, it was full circle. I visited her in London and she looked amazing. She really kind of had the body that she wanted, and she had a new romance and a partner that was kind of a, you know, he was a creative as well. He was a filmmaker, and she's proud of that. She's proud of where she was and that she had got through all of that. And I think people kind of forget these personal accomplishments that she made after 2008, 2009, which were great, you know. And even into 2011, she performed a series of concerts in Brazil that were incredible. And she was sober and super proud of herself. And we were video chatting from when she was in Brazil, and she was elated by it. She just really like remembered her talent and her ability to perform.
Do you think the focus is much too much on the struggles that she had? And
of course. I think with women, especially in the limelight, we focus on their issues and it's unfair. I think if a man had done things that she had done, people would probably applaud it and be like, oh, what a rock star. But because she was a woman, they just couldn't handle it. And they were looking at it in a way that was just like scarlet letter. Like, how dare you? And that's all it's still to this day, that's all people kind of focus on and are stuck on, the tragedy, the addiction, all of that. It's so not who she was. It's so not what's important. I think she lived such a full life and did incredible things in 27 years that none of us will probably ever do.
Yeah.
And the focus on her light and her love and her gifts and talents that she shared that we still get to enjoy.
You mentioned in the book that after Amy died, you kind of had these images hidden away in a closet and didn't take a look at them for a few years.
Yes.
I imagine that just because they were too painful to see at that point.
Well, I think when you lose anyone who you're that close to, she was like a sister to me. Like, of course you don't want to look at images of your sister who's dead. Like, that's just, I couldn't face it, you know? It doesn't, her fame and her, you know, all of that stuff, it's two separate things. I think my relationship with her is like family. And when you lose, when you lose family, it's difficult to face that and to grieve that. And it took me a long time to really grieve that loss. Grief is different for everybody, but I think there's a universal experience that we have. It cuts you. It really, it shakes your whole world. And because of our creative connection and that, that safety that we kind of provided for each other to be ourselves and to fully accept each other, it was a loss. And I have struggled to find that in another person. And I was young. I was 26 when she died. So I put the work away. I didn't think I would necessarily ever do anything with it. But I think after I had processed that grief and that loss, I realized that these images would be a way to honor her and maybe change the conversation around her. And I'm hoping that this book really changes the image that people have in their head of her during those years, because this is who she was to me and who I saw at that time.
Well, it is a very beautiful look at someone who we often didn't get to see in this light. So Blake, thanks so much for the book and for showing us this different side of Amy.
My pleasure.